Well, what do you know? The MCU's most powerful character, as in also powerfully divisive, is returning, with Captain Marvel 2 officially moving forward. I think Brie Larson, I think she learned her lesson from the blow-up over the first movie. I think she sanded down a lot of her edges, but still maintained what so many do love about her. I think that's important. She didn't back down. She just, I think, stopped picking fights. Very important for the star of a major franchise. And also, I think that the Russo brothers did a lot to help sand down some of those edges as well, as she was quite enjoyable, I think, in Avengers Endgame. And you know what? As I've said before, the more you watch Captain Marvel, the first movie, I think the more enjoyable it becomes. After the initial wave of disappointment goes away, that it's not quite as good as some of the other Marvel movies, you know? And you know, Brie Larson is very different than, you know, her depiction of the characters. Not only, and I think this is to her credit, not only different than the comics, but also very different than other female action heroes. She's like a little geeky, and I think at the end of the day quite likable. But speaking of the first movie, what's very unusual for a billion-dollar picture is that neither the directing duo who also worked on the script nor their co-writer are returning. As I said, very unusual for a movie that made $1 billion. We don't want any of you back. But let's be honest, is anyone sorry to see them go? Again, as I said, Captain Marvel is a fun movie. It gets better with each viewing. But, you know, you never like to have an asterisk like that on your movie. You like it to be good the first time around. But I really do think I put it more at the level of, let's say, Ant-Man and the Wasp, right? Than the movies that have the distinct personality elsewhere in the MCU. And those directors get to come back. But speaking of coming back, for some reason, Peyton Reed got rehired, right? If I were Bowden and Fleck, that would bother me forever. I'd be like, I gotta go, but Peyton Reed gets to come back? Are you kidding me? I made $1 billion. He's never made $1 billion. What? And Scott Derrickson, by the way, he didn't make $1 billion, but I thought Doctor Strange was very distinct, right? He just got fired. So maybe Kevin Feige just didn't personally care for this trio, right? After all, the MCU has become a family, and he is very much the head of that family. So why did Captain Marvel make $1 billion, right? It's a debate for the ages. I personally think it was a number of factors, right? Which is what, you know, what it usually is. So it was sandwiched between an amazing cinematic saga, 10 years in the making. And some people think that's the only thing that got it to $1 billion. I disagree. I think it introduces not only Marvel's first leading lady, but an incredibly powerful character. Interestingly, never that popular in the comics, which I think gives a lot of leeway for Larson and whoever takes over this next movie to maybe better define Captain Marvel, right? And also, Sam Jackson and Goose were a hoot. I don't really get the appeal of Goose, quite frankly. Not a very cute cat, in my opinion. But boy, people sure love Goose, particularly in Asia, interestingly enough. They had like a whole bunch of different cat, like Goose posters. It was hilarious. And I also have to give credit to Brie Larson, who might have her haters. Boy, does she! And again, she stopped picking fights with them, I think, to some degree. But she also has her diehard fans, and she knows how to mobilize them. A very important skill. Plus, of course, the first Captain Marvel set the stage for one of the greatest comic book crossover events of all time, Secret Invasion. So good! Which, after the end credits of Spider-Man Far From Home, is clearly coming sooner rather than later. Although, obviously, first, we're going to have to establish S.W.O.R.D. This is all very cool stuff. And I think after Kevin Feige tinkered with Civil War, he changed that story up a whole bunch. I'm fine with him changing these things for the movies. Although, do you? I don't know. Secret Invasion was good. It had some really great surprises. But it would require so much reading for you to truly get the shock of those surprises. I guess you can just enjoy the movie. But, you know, I never thought I'd like good Skrulls. But boy, do I. Thanks, Ben Mendelsohn. Skrulls drinking out of soda cups. Sold. All right, so anyway, will Captain Marvel 2 be a direct lead-up to Secret Invasion? Will it be an A-Force movie? Will it just be another adventure for Carol Danvers? It's really too early to tell. All that Marvel has revealed is that, unlike Wonder Woman, Captain Marvel's flashback days are over, as the sequel will take place in a present day. A brand new writer, I really do kind of want it to set up Secret Invasion, though. I'm not going to lie. All right, so anyway, it's such a good story. Let's get going. And then that sets up an Avengers movie. Who's a Skrull? I'm telling you, you're going to love that game. All right, so A brand new writer, Megan McDonnell, who got her start, she's like really new. Like her first professional gig is a staff writer on the new WandaVision series, which of course is very female-centric and features a grown-up Monica Rambeau, who apparently works for S.W.O.R.D. Get it? Sword and Shield. Hilarious, Marvel. McDonnell will be taking the first crack at the script. I say first crack because whoever they get to direct it, I'm sure will want to massage it a little bit. And we'll talk about directors in a moment, right? Potential directors. The pick, though, has been also set for 2022. Marvel's like, that's when we'd like it to come out, right? But they didn't pick a specific date, even though Kevin Feige has a number of dates already picked for that year. Black Panther has dibs on the May date. Perhaps the specific date wasn't announced because, again, Captain Marvel 2 is only starting to be developed and it might not make 2022. But no worries, Kevin Feige has plenty of prime dates on hold. And quite frankly, I think Captain Marvel deserves a May release date. So let's give her May 5th, 2023. I think she and Black Panther are obviously part of the new trinity, hopefully, of the Avengers. But if Guardians of the Galaxy 3 ain't ready on time, you know, let's see how long the Suicide Squad takes, she could get the July 29th, 2022 date. I don't love that date for her, to be honest about it. I don't love February is too small for her. October, gotta be Blade. I broke down Marvel's upcoming release schedule in a separate video. You can check it out via the link in the video description. But I really do feel that Captain Marvel is deserving of that prime May date. I mean, if Black Widow can get it, why, you know, let's put Captain Marvel back in there. All right, the Black Widow movie, again, looks very good. So who should direct? Well, Feige wants another female director, right? He kind of hedged his bets wanting a directing duo so he could get one guy in there, and I think he paid the price for it. If you've seen any of their previous films, I'm not at all surprised they couldn't deliver stronger material. I would not have hired them. When they got hired, I was like, let me watch this, like, Mississippi movie, and I couldn't even watch. It's hard not to get through a movie, especially if you watch them professionally, and I was like, I can't do it. All right, so anyway, he wants a female director. The understandable trend these days for female action movies, and luckily for Feige, a slew of them just leveled up. None of them nominated for an Oscar. And the Captain Marvel gig would make for sweet, sweet vindication and also some pretty sweet headlines, right? Oh, the Academy doesn't understand the value of these female directors, but Kevin Feige does. It writes itself. Maybe the Disney marketing department writes it and sends it out. All right, so part of me would love to see Greta Gerwig get it. I really would. Remember how she held hands with Laura Dern at the 2018 Oscars because she was nervous? I felt that was kind of unprofessional, but you know what? A lot of people thought it was charming. And you know who I bet thought it was charming? Brie Larson. I think that Greta Gerwig and Brie Larson would get along like crazy. Like they would really get along. I think that they are very much on the same wavelength. And then Saoirse Ronan, who always works with Gerwig, could be Carol's bestie, Jessica Drew. And that would be interesting. Although I get the sense Greta Gerwig's trying to not always have Saoirse Ronan in her movies, so she might welcome the break. Although Saoirse Ronan would be like, now you want to take a break when you join the MCU? You can do it on the next one. Little Women, if you haven't seen it, and if you haven't seen it, why not? It's amazing. It's a masterful portrait of female friendship, but also female ambition. It's great. And Gerwig, who would also rewrite McDonald's script, I don't think anybody would be upset about that because she did a fantastic job on Little Women, she also wrote, and I think she could do something really special with Captain Marvel 2. But there are two problems, which is why this probably won't happen. One, she's already set to direct and she's co-writing along with her significant other, Noah Baumbach, Warner Brothers. It's always Warner Brothers versus Disney. Their Barbie movie with Margot Robbie, right? I mean, who knows how fast that's moving along? She might have room for Captain Marvel in there, but I'm sure Warner Brothers would be like, it's moving along fast enough that you can't do Captain Marvel too. And also, the other problem with Gerwig is that she has no experience with action scenes or visual effects. As we know from many other directors, it takes one movie to truly get a good grip on them, which is why so often people's second movies really are amazing in terms of action and visual effects. Now, I was impressed with how Gerwig was able to level up from Lady Bird to Little Women. That was amazing. But that's the kind of dramatic leveling up that you would see with action and VFX. So it's kind of the same thing. I mean, she could learn, and the MCU is now infamous for having its own action directing unit, although they seem to have really delivered with Black Widow, with another female director who's never done any action or VFX work. But Captain Marvel is different than Black Widow. She's so powerful, and her sequel will surely have so much VFX, and it should have so much action. It better have a lot of action. I wouldn't want a director learning on the job, right? Especially for a sequel where, again, the audience expects things to really level up. So that makes my second choice Deborah Chow. That's right. Sorry, other Oscar-snubbed female directors, but Chow has experience with action and with franchise mythology, even Marvel. She's also proven to be a great team player on those projects. And after delivering for The Mandalorian, fans really like her, the sort of fans that really hate Brie Larson. And so Chow could really maybe balance out that situation with fans going, I sure still don't like Brie Larson, but I love Deborah Chow so much, and maybe Deborah Chow vouches for Brie Larson. I just think that it would work out really nicely. Now, of course, she's supposed to be doing the Disney Plus Obi-Wan show, but as I told you, I heard that show has been put on hold. Indefinite hold means it's not canceled, which they made very clear. But they have no idea when it's coming back. And in fact, they released the crew from their contracts because they don't know when they're going to be able to employ them, so they want the crew to be able to go and look for other work, including Deborah Chow. Look, I hope everything works out for the Obi-Wan Disney Plus show and it does come back online. But in the meantime, Chow can direct Captain Marvel 2. So what do you hope for this sequel? Talent-wise, behind the camera and in front of the camera if you want to play that game, and story-wise. And perhaps the most important question of all, long or short hair. I saw someone tweet that they really did not want the short hair to return for the sequel that she had in Avengers Endgame. I gotta say, I vote short because it's so iconic to the character. And also, I think Brie Larson rocks a short haircut. I mean, in Avengers Endgame, it was clearly a wig. She'd have to actually cut her hair for a whole movie. But I thought it looked really, really good. And I think, again, the character is very aggressive. I think Brie Larson makes her maybe even a little bit more aggressive than she needs to be. But I think the short hair kind of like adds to that image, you know, I think it's interesting. It's a harsher look, but I think it softens the overall character. I like it a lot. I really like it. That's what I like. But what I want the most, as I said, is lots of action sequences. I love how powerful Captain Marvel is. And when she burst into the scene, literally at the end of Avengers Endgame, it brought a tear to my eye. I haven't reacted like that since I saw the end of Monsters vs. Aliens with Reese Witherspoon's character. And that's part of also why I think Captain Marvel, the first movie, made $1 billion. It, representation matters! I know everybody says it doesn't, but if you usually if you think representation doesn't matter, you've already got it. All right, so that's my thoughts on Captain Marvel 2. I'm excited to hear yours down below. Subscribe today, and of course, as always, you can check out some more videos right now.